Please welcome again Kirsten Johnson. Where is she? Here she is.
Thank you so much on behalf of everyone who's a part of this. This is definitely one of these situations where I could bring down more than half of the audience in terms of how much you all have supported the making of this film. And I just want to acknowledge a couple of people who lived through this with me. So Judy Karp is here tonight, who's my sound person collaborator. Stand up, Judy. So in a lot of what you saw, it was just Judy and me together, and then there are several of the directors who I worked with shooting this. Laura Poitras is here, Ginny Redeker is here, and I know there are others of you. Lisa Collins is here. There are a lot of people who, Kathy Leichter is here, who was in the film. And then there are the people who helped make the film happen on a production level, all the people at Fork Films, Elise Pettis, Abby Stranahan, Elizabeth Adams, the art group. And we're gonna introduce the producing partners who I made this film with, Marilyn Ness and Daniel Varga, who made this film possible.
Where's Danielle and Marilyn?
Oh, here you are.
I'm putting them in the middle because they are really, it was a really small group of people who made this film, and the belief and the work of these two extraordinary women is a huge reason why we're here tonight. So, Marilyn Ness, producer, and Daniel Varga, co-producer.
Well, I was just going to start with one question for you, Kirsten, but I think it probably will involve all three of you, which for you is basically what brought you to make this film after all these films that you've shot and done this work on that made you think to make this beautiful film, and talk about that, but then talk about where the two of you came in and how you all helped to form this into the beautiful piece it is.
Yeah, well, really. Thank you, Marianne. I mean, I never imagined making this particular film, and this film, as many in the room know, arose out of a profoundly difficult failure, I would say, a loss and a failure, which was a film I started to make in Afghanistan, and that one shot in the walking sequence that you see with the young woman with the headscarf that you see from behind, I had made a film with her and with the young man who's blind in one eye, Najib. And when she saw the finished film, she said, I'm afraid I can't be in this movie. It will be too dangerous for me to be in this movie. And so that film, after 3 years worth of work, fell apart. And then I started to try to imagine how to create a film without showing her face. And in the course of doing that, I had the good fortune of meeting Marilyn Ness. And by the time I met Marilyn, I really realized I needed help because I'd been working alone with one wonderful editor, Amanda Laws, over the course of a couple of years. And I was trying to do everything by myself and had completely lost perspective. And I was starting, it was around these questions of permission. You know, when you film with people, you know that they have a relationship to letting themselves be filmed that is a fluctuating, changing relationship, and you're trying to honor that. And so when this fell apart with this young Afghan girl, I started thinking about all these different stories back in time that had to do with questions that I asked myself. And so I was searching back into footage, and that's when I brought Marilyn onto the project, and Marilyn can give her perspective about where she thought I was at that moment in time.
Right. So, I mean, I think a lot of people could have just stopped with the first film and said, okay, that didn't work, let's move on to the next. But I admired your bravery to keep going with it, and not only to question how did you miss the fact that she no longer was feeling safe enough to consent, but then started bringing in all the other questions that as filmmakers we have, and maybe we try not to ask ourselves or try to keep out of the footage, but she allowed herself to kind of dredge all of that up. And so when I came on, there was an attempt to sort of string together all of this footage she was bringing back into the universe, sort of pulling out of boxes and getting directors to let her use. And we sat down and there was a 3-hour cut that I mostly watched like this. It was very traumatic. We have since named it the trauma cut. And it was a lot of the baby in Nigeria and a lot of genocides and pain. And the first thing I said to Kirsten is, I hope you're in therapy. Because she was clearly working her way through something, and I wasn't sure I had the capacity to help her do that, but I thought, well, we could figure out how to make a film. We actually stopped editing. That was the first big maneuver.
This is the great act of the great producer, was to tell me to stop editing.
Right, it was sort of a compulsion happening, and it was like, there's too little money, and we don't have that much. So we shut that off, and then Kirsten spent time, I think, being with material and bringing more in and thinking about it and processing it. And then we, after about 8 months, Kirsten found the wonderful Nels Bangerter, who really was the one who, with Kirsten, Kirsten spoke to him for a long time. And he lived in San Francisco and she lived in New York. And that was also the great blessing, because she couldn't be with him in the edit room. She had to tell him what she was imagining. And then he was like, okay, thanks. And he'd like drag the footage into his lair and do stuff with it. So so that was our process.
Mm-hmm. And so Danielle, when did you come in this process? I find it really interesting that it comes from a failure of a film that you made to becoming something very, very, very personal that also has bits of your own life and your family in it. Sure. Tell us how you got into that.
So I was kind of in the periphery during the whole trauma cut, like kind of the nitty gritty.
Wrapping the DVD,
Not sure you'd want it. I actually came on around the same time as Nels Bangerter came on, and I'll just talk about, so the instructions for Nels was really like, here are three quick like log lines for this set of footage. Do with what you can. And what Kirsten has and had a lot of specific memories, things that are beyond the footage that you'll see related to all of those shoots. And he really, went with it, kind of bearing some of the basic notes in mind. And he made this 40-minute cut, and that's around the time I came on. And not having known where it came from, it was quite an incredible experience to watch this new version of what the film could be. And it was us three in a room, and Nels, on Skype, joined us later for notes. And Kirsten was actually it was a very emotional, moving time, because what Nels did, looking through all of this footage, probably some footage that she dismissed, came out with this 40-minute cut that was funny, that was beautiful. You have these elements like the lightning scene, and he really was able to bring out all of the beauty and the joy and like that laughter and that human connection that I think you see Kirsten having with all of her subjects in the way that she films. So that was kind of a big turning point. And also, giving the film its own language, there's no narration, there's very limited cards. And from there on, that's kind of figuring out how the film would be as a, both as a feature and all of the, logistics and practicalities of what you have to deal with to get to that phase. That's kind of where I joined.
Could I just add one thing? Absolutely. Which is that same screening. I think we all were worried. We hadn't really watched the film through. And we really hadn't watched the film through since the trauma cut. And the lights
Which
came
like
up.
A year earlier.
Yeah,
really long time
we really had
before.
Stepped away. Yeah. And the lights came up and Kirsten, we were moved and gave our notes. And then Kirsten turned to Nels on Skype and she said, thank you so much for giving me back what I love about what I do. I think she lived with so much sadness and pain. And she got to come back to her work. And we're glad you came back to your work. I think we all are, collectively.
Yes, I think we're all glad. And actually, since we want to get to you, we will go out to you, and maybe I'll ask another question later. So let's see if there are any questions out here. Questions, comments, inside stories. I know it's a nice inside group. Yes. So this is a question. When you're shooting, how do you keep yourself out of the story?
Well, I mean, it's so interesting because I don't feel like I'm out of the story. You know, I feel very much there. And I know that I have a responsibility, that I have a pact with the director that I'm working with, and we're trying to follow and understand a story as it's unfolding. But I've always felt like the camera connects me more to people. And one of the interesting things of doing this work, of going through all of the footage, was to realize how much I've compartmentalized and how much the sort of the technical necessity of living in the moment of, like, I need a battery. My camera's gonna run out while I'm shooting this baby struggling for its life. How that helps you cope in these moments when you really are feeling overwhelmed, and, you know, obviously also the camaraderie that you share with the people that you're there with. So Laura and I are laughing in the car in Sana while we're terrified about being arrested. Judy and I are gasping together with the axes, you know, with the babies. And you're sharing the space behind the camera, knowing that you have a responsibility, and then sometimes you transgress and you break across the barrier. And, you know, like the moment where I ask the grandmother in Sarajevo how she got her sense of style, because I just couldn't bear anymore to have her questioned around the war. I just wanted to let her, you know, get to be in a different way than as a spokesperson for her victimization.
Yes.
So
how's your vision of...
He's just saying you spent so much time around the world. How has your vision of the world changed? I mean, I would say the thing that I do see very quickly is systems. Like, you can sort of understand systems at work all around the world. But I have Nels's work in this film gave me back connections that I hadn't seen before. I'm a person who's very preoccupied with questions of... injustice around race, and it's so interesting to look at this film and see how much of it is about women's experience at many different stages of life in it. And so that, you know, making this film, I've worked a long time with Ginny Redeker, who is always like, women, 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 and I'm always like, race, race, race. And so it was so funny for me to, like, see this film. It's like, oh, I have been seeing, like, these questions of family and how do you struggle to keep your family well in times of war? How do you cope with trauma after the fact? So I think that that's one of the things that we wanted to create in the film, is this idea of accumulation. And at a certain point, this accumulation of having been in so many places where it's just like, oh, like, the poor people are getting screwed again and so badly, you know, like, that at a certain point, you wonder, am I doing anything? Is making this film doing anything? And it really weighs on you.
We actually also saw, I think, through the footage and through the years, Kirsten evolving as a person, right? So I remember the day you blew my mind when I hadn't put the connection together that the baby in Nigeria was a twin. Like, I just hadn't put that in my head. And then she comes and she's like, and then I had the twins. And it was like, phew. And you know she takes that with her to the next shoot with the next babies and the next mothers. And I think that, you know, that evolution opens her up in new ways and will bring the next director some piece they had never seen before. So I was always, you know, I've gotten to watch it a few times, but to keep drawing the threads through the material and see connections I hadn't seen before has been exciting on my end. Mm.
As a cinematographer, what's the ideal relationship that you can have with a director?
I mean, you saw that long list of how many directors I've worked with. I have many ideals, and every single director works completely differently. And then I found they work completely differently on each different film. So that's one of the great joys of being a member of the crew. And I love it when people acknowledge that we as the crew contribute. When the director understands that the sound person has as significant things to ask, when the director realizes that the driver of the car is actually more connected to the place than any of us are. And I have many great directors who I've worked with who do that. And that's when I feel really excited, is when a director acknowledges sort of everyone on the team and everyone that we are filming as equal partners in this act of making a film together.
And something that we see here in all these different pieces, because they say all these things are done really well, that the audience should not necessarily notice the sound and how the things look because it's all of a piece. But here you can see just with, you know, a quick sound and with images how it all works together. That's just been done wonderfully. Yes? Do you feel any different when you were filming your family, your mother?
Yeah, I mean, my mother, during her lifetime before she had Alzheimer's, never wanted to be filmed by me, and you know, was very cared very much about her image. And so that in that first scene where you see me filming her at the ranch, I really was sort of sneaking that footage because I, you know, sort of pretending I'm doing a home movie, but I really wanted to film her. But you can see my self-consciousness about it, and it really felt like a betrayal. And then the last footage you see where she comes back to life, where she pops back out of the box, you know, that was just me in utter desperation, knowing that she was going to die soon and wanting to capture some part of her. But I think for me, it was really important to include both my mom and my children in this because I believe we are all camera people now. We all have phones in our pockets and we're all making decisions about, do I play with my child in this moment or do I film them? Do I take a picture of them? My parent is dying. Do I film this moment so I can keep them forever? And we're all facing the ethical ramifications of this all around the world, and those images can be distributed out into the world. So I think, you know, it used to be that I was one of the few people who could film my family, and now we all are people who can do that.
Yes. Talk about going back to Bosnia.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so you're sharing this experience of feeling loss, of having to leave people all the time, which I think was also part of the accumulation for me. And I kept trying to convince Marilyn that I needed to go back into Boko Haram territory in northern Nigeria to meet this family with the baby. And she was like, no, you can't go.
Let's do Bosnia.
Yeah. And I really wanted to go back, you know, really wanted to go back there, and still in part of me does, but it's not the right thing to do for the family. So I got this opportunity to go to Sarajevo to do a workshop for young Eastern European filmmakers. And I called Velma, the translator, and I said, will you and Seo drive me up to the mountain? And it was such a remarkable thing to have the conversation with Velma and Seo on the way driving up there about what they had experienced since our crew had left, and all of the women who'd been raped who keep calling Seo and wanting him to drive them around. And so I even before we got to the mountain, I was like, I gotta film with Velma and Seo. But then we got to the mountain and it was a really powerful, amazing time with them. And so they were so happy to see me. And one of the things that was really interesting was that they were really excited to hear that I had children, because I hadn't had children when I'd gone the first time. And you know, this is a Muslim family in the countryside. And at a certain point I realized, you know, we do this thing when we film of not revealing really who we are to the people who we film. And so at a certain point I said to Velma, I think I need to tell the family how it is that I have my children. And some of you in the room know, and others don't, that I co-parent my children with Ira Sachs and Boris Torres, who are a married couple. And we live next door to each other, and the kids go back and forth. And our wonderful nanny, Carmenza, who takes care of them when I'm away, is here tonight. And so I was like, I gotta tell them. You know, I gotta tell them that this is the story of my family. And so I'm like, you know, haltingly going through this story, and they're all staring at me, and it's getting translated. And I'm like, here we go, we're doing this. And I had no idea what they were gonna say. And the woman who is so generous to me in the way she listens to me in the footage, who's nodding for me, she says, the men who are the fathers of your children are very brave people. I'm very proud of them for figuring out a way to have children. And I said, you know what brave is? And she said, I know what brave is. So, you know, it's this thing of like, if you choose to interact with people in an honest way, life is a beautiful thing. Yeah.
I think we're going to have to cut this short, but I think maybe we can take one more question, if there is. All right, I'm just going to ask you one quick thing, just a final thing from you all. Because in making the film, how much, and I'm sure it was so emotional every time you would see a cut, but where was the unemotional part where you might have all sat down, almost with pencil and paper, and going, you know, let's not do this, how do we do this, and working through it that way? Was there ever sort of an unemotional way of working through the editing process of the film? Or was it all so, I can imagine it's always so emotional with all this footage.
Well, I was going to say, it was funny, you know, the first few cuts that I saw, especially with the baby in Nigeria, I was like, you know, I'm sure many of you too, I was kind of holding my breath and not watching and not able to watch and absorbing all of this information. And I remember at some point down the line, I was like that feeling had totally gone. And I don't know how or when that happens, but I think at some point, you know, watching the same footage over and over again, you just become familiar with it. But that was a very strange point for me to see how different footage felt for me watching it. Although, just watching it again now, having not seen it for a while, there are parts that have moved me, but I think when you're really in the middle of it, there's just a separation.
But then I would say also the way the film worked, you had to always watch it in sequence because pieces would move, right? And it's not a straight narrative. So moving pieces in relation to each other may reinvigorate a scene that had been not working before, or took the emotion out or added the emotion in, or having this sort of religious scene, like being in the mosque after painful things, you can have these moments of quiet. So I found it kept shifting because they moved these pieces around a lot for a very long time until the end. So.
I just, you know, this film is so alive for me in such a particular way. I want to share that Danielle's grandmother died a couple of weeks ago, and she's wearing her beautiful shoes. And, you know, this is what this film is for me, is this way. And, like, you know, we never imagined that we would be on this stage in this moment, and you would be wearing her shoes, and it would connect to this film in the ways that it does. And, Marianne, I just want to ask you, since it's your last Q&A here in this, What has this work been to you?
I'm really happy that this is like the last film that I'm doing a Q&A for in New Directions, because it really brings out everything that film does, I think, and to me that's the most important thing. As you talk about, you know, reworking things and the emotion and the non-emotion of things, and how in the end, and as you said, Danielle, you get the point of just working through things, but then you see it again now and it all comes back to you. And that's what filmmaking is about, and even though I'm still gonna do other film things elsewhere, New Directors has been so incredibly moving to me all these years, because that's what it is. It's directors creating new work that just moves us constantly. So, and you have done it all in spades.
Right.
Thank you very, very, very much.